You can hear me now, all of you? Can you hear me? Please, somebody let me know whether you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So 25 people are here right now. Let the others join, but we'll start the discussion. Last class we were discussing about the impacts of nutrient loading. Nutrients are nothing but organic rich materials, living or non-living, which pollute the water. They may be weeds, water weeds, or they may be decomposed organic materials which are remains of plants or animals, or they also may be some microorganisms which get into the water unexpectedly. The best examples of nutrients I have told: carbonates, nitrates, sulfates containing materials, and other organic compounds. The thing I last told was about blue baby syndrome, which is caused by the concentration of nitrates. Nitrates, if present excessively in the mother's body, may attack the embryo and cause the baby, born baby, to be in blue color. So that is what is called blue baby syndrome. Even if not born with blue color, this can happen after birth also. Maybe after birth, maybe after 5-6 months, the body color of the baby gets blue. It indicates that the nitrate which are inside the body are being converted to nitrites. ATES converts to ITES in the stomach, and that leads to a decrease in the hemoglobin. The hemoglobin in the presence of nitrites will convert to what is called methemoglobin. So the formation of methemoglobin is that which causes the blue baby disease. This is not a very common disease, but it is there. Even in Kerala, it is vastly reported, blue baby disease. So it is due to the presence of nitrates in water. And nitrates will be possible where the sewage contamination is very high. And you know that the sewage, especially the human fecus and similar other black soils which join the water, do have abundant quantities of nitrates. So any animal excreta is having abundant quantities of nitrates. So if these nitrates are joining the water, it can end up in the body of the mothers, and it can get transmitted to the children, and the children can get their hemoglobin converted to methemoglobin. Methemoglobin is bluish in color, and that is why instead of the red being red, the blood being red, the blood may become blue. That is called blue baby syndrome. Now see the next slide. How we can prevent the nutrient pollution? I told that nutrient pollution is nothing but polluting elements joining the water. Especially it is not advisable in drinking water. If it is in bathing water or cooking water, it may not be that much dangerous, because bathing, obviously, we are taking over the skin only. But if it is coming to drinking water, it is going directly into the body. It causes all these difficulties. That is why we say that drinking water should be the best water possible. Not like, the other waters. Drinking water should be the best possible. So, from the urban runoff means water flowing out from the cities instead of the villages. So many things can come up in the water, like the pet waste. Pet waste means, some pet animals may be there, especially in urban areas. Then some bacteria may be there. Then algae may be there, especially if some dry area is there. If moisture, sometimes they get algae may grow. So these are all possible. Then another thing is to prevent these nutrients entering the runoff. Runoff means the water which is running off to the water streams. Instead of the water percolating the ground, the water runs off into the running stream, and that is called the runoff water. So the runoff water will have all these pollutants. So to prevent that, we can have some treatment system at home itself. A simple treatment system is a filter. For example, before letting out the water through the channels or through the drains, if there's a filter, many of these things can be filtered. That is one thing. And the second thing is, in our own houses, we can have some treatment system. Take, for example, the water coming from the water closet, we can treat it in the septic tank. The water coming from the bathroom, that is having a lot of soap. And I told in the last class that soap is having a lot of fatty acids. So all these fatty acids and the chemicals which are coming in the toilet soaps or detergents for use for washing, they can be allowed to be filtered. Especially, I don't know when some of you heard that session day before yesterday on rainwater harvesting. When we are storing the rainwater, we always see to it that a filtering is done to the rainwater. A filtering by means of three layers of filter: sand filter, then coal powder or charcoal powder filter, and then baby metal filter. So if this filtering is done, much of the waste materials in the water can be prevented from entering the runoff. So you, instead of letting off the polluted water to the runoff and thus to the river, you can partly treat the water at home and send it. Maybe it's a bit costly, but in many of the foreign countries, this system is compulsory. When you construct a house, you also have to show what is the wastewater treatment system you are doing. Here it is in India, it is compulsory for industries. In India, for households, the compulsion is only for toilet waste, only for the latrine waste. For bathing waste and all, treatment system is not compulsory. That is why the bathing water, which is after wasting, it is called sullage, S-U-L-L-I-G. Sullage is normally let out to the drains in many of the towns. Even in Palakkad town, if you just move around, you can see the bathroom water is coming directly to the street. And that smell may be there. Because the bathroom water may not have as foul smell as the latrine water, but still it is having a smell. So this is a difficulty, but that can be avoided by slight treatment at the house itself, at the household itself, so that a level of filtering at the household can reduce the impact of this. Then another thing is civil engineering activities which are going on, especially the civil engineering activities like construction, road building, mining, also the natural activities like erosion, agriculture, etc. They loosen a lot of sediments, particles, and it is also sent to the runoff water. But if there are sufficient trees, as I have told earlier, sufficient trees with spread roots, this pollution can be maximum reduced. So a tree is a panacea. Planting a lot of trees is a panacea for all types of pollution activities. So atmospheric pollution as well as water pollution. Then what are the effects of the water pollutants? The one effect of the water pollutant is that the sediment buildup. Sediments means, I told in the last class, sediment means particles which are being deposited by the water. That is called sediment. So the sediment reduces the ability of waterways to control floods, because these sediments, I told that these sediments are suspended in water by an electric charge which causes repulsion between the particles, and that movement of the particles with an electric charge is called the Brownian movement. Because of the Brownian movement, the sediments will be moving in the water. But the moment they lose their charge, they lose their electric charge, immediately they settle down. This happens on the way. Whenever water is flowing, the small particles in the water, which are called sediments, do settle down and they accumulate over there. When solid particles accumulate in water bodies, it blocks the path of the water. And if the path of the water is blocked, it leads to flood if it is a river. If it's a drain, it leads to overflow. That is one difficulty. Another difficulty is When these sediments are very much in water, it becomes turbid, means mixed with the color, because the particles will be suspended in the water. So they become very dark. They become very dark, and this dark water will prevent sunlight from entering the water. When the sunlight is prevented from entering the water, antiseptic conditions do prevail, and antiseptic organisms, antiseptic means those which do not want sunlight or air, their antiseptic organisms will definitely, because the cleansing activity by the sunlight is not there. Sunlight is having a lot of ultraviolet rays also, which may kill these organisms. But that doesn't happen when sediments are high. So the sediments, the suspended particles in the water, prevent the sunlight from entering the drains or water bodies, and thus the growth of unwanted living organisms like microbes may happen inside the water. So that is not advisable. And another thing is, the sediments are normally blackish in color because they are suspended particles, dust particles, carbon particles, soot particles. They are suspended in water and they are dark. So you know that dark water can absorb more sunlight. So dark water will be absorbing more sunlight, and this sunlight will definitely heat up the water. So the normal temperature water will heat up. And when the water heats up, you know, the oxygen will escape. The oxygen, dissolved oxygen will be more in cold water compared to hot water. Hot water, the dissolved oxygen will escape. That means the self-cleansing capacity of the water or the self-purification capacity of the water will be lost heavily. And this can lead to lower biodiversity, because if the dissolved oxygen, whether it is a river or sea, if the dissolved oxygen is lost, the fish cannot live inside. And of course, I was telling you about some fish in Kerala. I checked the internet for the common fish in Kerala. I told you about a very, very soft fish in Kerala, which is called a kuruva. Kuruva in rivers in Kerala. That fish is called a dania in English, dania. Similarly, I told about another fish called varal, or in North Malabar it is called bral. That fish is called snake head fish. Then in Travancore area, there is a common fish which we call as karetti in Malayalam. It's with a lot of bones and all. That fish is called, what is that fish? Oh, I'll tell you right now. Then another fish I told, which is in deep water, which I know I told it can live with a very less oxygen. That fish is called catfish. Catfish is called, in Malayalam we call it as kari. And then there is white catfish, which is called kuri in Malayalam. So these are all some of the other fish which I told, karetti. In Malayalam it is called karetti, and that is called in English as carp, CARP. So these are the common fish varieties in the fresh waters in Kerala. Of course, other waters, you know, the sea fish like mackerel, sardine. Mackerel means ayala, sardine means mati, then prawns, chemmeen, then shark, srav. These are all very common fish items. Then kingfish. Kingfish means, you would have heard sometimes, kingfish. Kingfish, searfish, etc. Okay. Kingfish nu parnale naimeen aanu South Kerala paraya, North Kerala ilana ikora nu parayum. Then karimeen ennu parnoru fish undu. That is called pearl fish. So yesterday I casually checked the corresponding English names of all these fishes. It is better to remember these names. So the biodiversity will decrease when the water is with sediments. When the water is with so much of sediments, light cannot enter it. And since the light is not entering, the metabolism or the photosynthesis of the sea plants or water plants will not happen. So the sea or river will become with less fish content, fish load. So that is also a dangerous phenomena which can happen. Now, how we can prevent sediment pollution? This is very common practice which we use in our rural area. Wherever we see that water will flow away, eroding the sand or soil in that area, we construct there screens. We construct screens there to prevent the soil particles being taken away by erosion. Screens or traps. അതിനെന്താ മലയാളത്തിൽ പറയാ? സ്ക്രീൻസ് ഓർ ട്രാപ്സ്? മലയാളത്തിൽ എന്ത് പറയാം? സംബഡി പ്ലീസ് ടെൽ മീ. യു ക്യാൻ സീ ദാറ്റ് ഫിഗർ ആൻഡ് ടെൽ മീ വാട്ട് യു ഗിഫ്, വാട്ട് യു കോൾ ദാറ്റ്, ദാറ്റ് യു ക്യാൻ സീ ദാറ്റ് ഫെൻസിങ് വിച്ച് ഇസ് ഗിവൺ ദർ. അതിന് മലയാളത്തിൽ എന്താ പറയുക? എനിബഡി പ്ലീസ് പുട്ട് ഓൺ ദ ചാറ്റ് ബോക്സ്. In that photo, there is a barrier for the soil erosion. It's a constructed barrier. What do you call that in Malayalam? Jisi, can you tell me? In Malayalam, what we can say for that? Ah, yes. What do you can say for that? A barrier which we construct so that the soil erosion can be prevented with that. A photograph is given here. This is very common in Kerala also. In Malabar area, they do it with some thick cloths and all. In Travancore area, they constructed mostly with thatched leaves, coconut leaves thatched. They'll construct it. Kayala Veli ennaku parayum. You are right. Kayala Veli ennaku parayum. Okay. So that is good enough. Only thing is, it should let out water, not the solid. If water is not let out, it will become a liquid form inside, and then it will flow away. So permitting water to go away and not permitting solid particles to see, in Western countries, they have got standard screen cloths available for this. Screen type cloth. You'd have seen that green screen cloths are used for sun shading. Whenever you have a garden or a horticulture area, you use green sheets above it with perforations in it. So that we call 20% sheet, 40% sheet, 60% sheet, etc., based on how much percentage of sunlight is permitted. Okay, so those sheets also can be used for this purpose. Okay, so that the soil erosion is trapped, or the sediments are trapped in it. Then roads also, the road which we travel can also cause a lot of pollution, water pollution. For example, when we use the brake, some element of copper is released, because you know that the brake drum is there. Brake drum mostly will have some copper alloy. Okay, I think those who use the vehicles, bike or car, will be knowing what is a brake drum. Inside the wheel, there is a round element which brakes. That is called the brake drum. Similarly, all the vehicles have got what is called engine oil. You know that this engine oil will slightly come out of the vehicle, a bit, but that also can fall onto the road. Many times you are walking or traveling on the road, you can see oil on the road. It's a bit of engine oil plus grease. Grease also will come, you know, for lubricating the machine parts in an automobile, we use grease. So this grease is also a condensed oil actually. More viscous oil is called grease. So these things will come onto the road and they will also join the water. Okay. Then another thing is some salts. In Western countries, in the winter season, mostly at night, the road will be covered with snow. So the best technique to remove the snow is, in the morning, spray some de-icing salts. De-icing will be normally done by salt solution, so that the ice will melt away immediately. So that also will have some chemicals. Similarly, in many of the things being transported on the roads, we may have petrochemicals like benzene, like kerosene, etc. They may leak from the tanks of the vehicle. Say, for example, the benzene tank is moving on the road. Quite naturally, some drops of benzene may escape. Similarly, petrol, diesel, kerosene tanks are moving on the road. A very light leakage is possible in all these things. Okay, in LPG, leak is not possible because it is so tight. LPG cylinders are so airtight because if that escape, it may easily catch fire. But if a drop of kerosene or benzene escapes, it may not catch fire. So except for LPG and LNG cylinders, all other containers or tankers can have a bit of leak of oils, and that also will run off with the water and will join the water body. So from the land itself, oils and such things can join the water. And remember, many of these oils, especially chemicals like benzene, methane, etc., are carcinogenic. What do you mean by carcinogenic? What do you understand by carcinogenic? Many of these chemical compounds are carcinogenic. Any idea what do you understand by carcinogenic? Anybody? What do you understand by carcinogenic? It is written on that slide that carcinogenic. Yes. Yes, yes, this is right. This is perfectly right. Carcinogenic means cancer causing. I think I have told you in the class sometime earlier, cancer can be caused by many reasons, by genetic mutations, by poisons, by certain pollutants, by sunlight, excessive ultraviolet rays. All these are causative forces for cancer. A single reason for cancer is not yet found. Cancer is occurring. See, even tobacco chewing, chewing of tobacco, smoking, these are all reasons said to be for cancer. Cancer is nothing but unproportionate or non-proportionate growth of our body cells. Instead of keeping a regular shape, some of the body cells start growing in a random way, unpredictable way. That is called cancer, one way of cancer. Another way of cancer is some body cells start dying all of a sudden. In some parts of the body, either the body cells are growing awkward or the body cells are starting dying. Both these can be symptoms of cancer. Okay, so you can understand now cancer. And that is why the radio technique is used for treating cancer. What do you mean by radio technique? Radioactive rays. Radioactive rays means mostly gamma rays or such powerful rays or X-rays or electron rays. All these rays, depending on the requirement, will be specifically used for killing these cells. So the radio treatment of cancer is by killing by radioactive rays these haphazard cells which grow improportionately or which die without any reason. So they will be removed by killing them. And that is the reason, so that a bit of the nearby cells also will be killed so that it will not spread easily. This is the radio treatment. So cancer treatment in oncology, cancer treatment is called oncology. Oncology is the treatment of cancer. In oncology, there is a special branch called radio-oncology, whereby radiation, you can treat the cancer patient. And radio-oncology is a specialized area for cancer treatment for any type of cancers, any part of the body. Now, many of these chemicals which get into the water are carcinogens. Then the other type of pollutant which get into the water is what is called leachate. Leachate can be chemical pollutants or biological pollutants. Leaching means kaluga. Kaluga in Malayalam, leaching. So leachate means kalugi baki varuna vellam. That is leachate. So if some waste is there on the land, the rainwater will wash it perfectly. And that washed water then becomes leachate. So that will flow into the runoff. It can have biological contaminants. It can have chemical pollutants. It can have poisons. All this will get into the drinking water ultimately because it goes to the river. The river goes to the reservoir. And from the reservoir, we are taking water. So all this, say for example, in one of the classes I have mentioned you, around 1 kilometer away from Malambada Reservoir, there is a medical waste treatment unit. That is owned by IMA. Its name is IMAGE. Newspaper report came that leachate from that medical waste treatment unit is coming to Malambada. There was a lot of hue and cry because medical waste, of course, it is very poisonous compared to other waste. And medical waste is highly infectious also. You know, medical waste can have the remains of anything, COVID, AIDS, or influenza, whatever it is, dysentery. All these things can have in medical waste because it is coming from the hospitals. That is why there was a lot of discussion over it. And many of the leachate coming from land may have dangerous heavy metals such as lead, cadmium, iron, mercury, etc. And you know that we use a lot of mercury and cadmium in batteries and electronics items for soldering purpose. And in addition to that, if there are some biological contents, bacteria, nitrates, sulfates, these are all present in biological contents. Then hazardous chemicals. Hazardous chemical means that we'll be discussing later in detail, say many of the pesticides. Pesticides which are used for killing the pest in the farm, agriculture land. So similarly, a lot of leachates can come. And another thing is, in waste management, I have told one method of disposing the solid waste is landfill it. In large area, dispose the solid waste and then cover it with the soil cover. So the solid waste, like in Vilappulchala at Thiruvananthapuram, a lot of solid waste will be disposed there, and over that around 1 to 2 feet of soil will be filled. And when the rains come, this soil will penetrate water, and that penetrating water will go to the leachate. The leachate will be washed out, and that washed out water will be coming outside, and that is very much unhealthy water, because all the bad nutrients and chemicals, poisons may be there in that water. And Thiruvananthapuram, it became an issue because this water, this leachate water, went to the Karavanayar, and people were agitating against it because the river water became so much foul smelling and colored. That can happen. So we have to have monitoring. And moreover, this leachate water can even pollute the groundwater. If it goes down, all the nearby people will get foul water with smell and color. That also happened there. So leachate in general is not advisable for drinking water. Then other pollution methods by which the water may be polluted are thermal pollution. Thermal pollution can occur in many ways. Say, for example, the well or the pond or the river or the sea is getting directly exposed to hot sunlight. Water may get heated over. Then another thing is the road surface is very hot. When water is raining, that rainwater all of a sudden will become hot, and that hot water runs off. Then another method is warm water discharges. For example, I told thermal power plants may discharge hot water, mostly into the sea. Nuclear power plants may discharge very hot water. Nuclear power plant, the hotness of the water is so high, it may be even 70, 80 degree hot water, very hot. And then, some power generating arrangements other than these nuclear power plants and thermal plants, especially diesel power plants and such things are there. Then some will be released. Then dark colored sediments also can enter into the water. Dark colored sediments mostly from agriculture lands. Agriculture lands, we use a lot of things. We use fertilizers, we use chemicals, we use pesticides, we use herbicides, we use weedicides. All these things are basically polluting the water. It may enter the water. And ultimately, these things will go to the aquatic habitat, where the fish and the water organisms have to live. So many of them take a lot of oxygen to decompose, whether it is chemical or biological contaminant. And when the water body is having a dissolved oxygen of 7, when these chemicals and pollutants join the water, all of a sudden the water content may say reduced to 2 or 3 milligram per liter. And that is the deficiency in oxygen in the water body, which we call as hypoxia. I told in the last class, what is hypo means less than required. Hyper means more than required. So, for example, you may have blood pressure and the sugar, say hypoglycemia, the sugar content in the body is less. You know that the sugar content has to be around at least 60 units. That is a different unit, but at least 60 units, otherwise you will feel a lot of tired. If it is above 150 or 200, we may say it's very high. Okay, it's beyond the limit. So that is then hyperglycemia. Glycemia means blood sugar content is expressed as glycemia. So if the sugar content is, similarly, you have hypotension and hypertension. Hypotension means the body pressure is less than required. Hypertension means the body pressure is more than required. Anybody can say what is a required body pressure, required blood pressure of our body? Our body has got two measures for blood pressure. One is systolic pressure, which is the higher one, and the other one is diastolic pressure. Systolic pressure and diastolic pressure. So you can test it by means of a sphygmomanometer. When you go to hospital, The doctors will test it by means of a sphygmomanometer. What is your body pressure, systolic and diastolic? Nowadays, you know, digital meters are available. I have told your HOD is to devise a new manometer instead of buying a manometer which is very costly. I think some of you can take up this research. This manometer basically, the digital manometer will basically have a reading unit and a pressure unit. The pressure unit by pumping some, with the help of battery, by pumping some air, you can make the pressure unit. You have to wrap it around the hand and pressure can be created. Then the other one, that is the reading unit, is normally a digital unit. So combined, it costs around 3,000 to 4,000 rupees. But more than half of the price is for the digital unit. So that digital unit can be easily replaced by your mobile, because mobile has got much more than the capacity of this digital unit. So I have told your HODs, electronics, computer science, and electrical HODs, to take the inventive capacity of the student to find a new device which can be connected to the mobile instead of buying a digital unit. So for 1,000 rupees, you can make a digital manometer. It can be connected to the mobile either through that charging cord, or I think charging cord will be better because charge can come out of that. Okay, or through that earphone port is there. Either through the earphone port or through the charging port, you can connect a device, a pressure device, so that the mobile can give you exact reading of diastolic and systolic pressure. Some of you please do this research and come out with an equipment, and we can take a patent in the name of our college. So teachers also will help you, because you are electronics and computer science people, you can devise this. This is an invention. If it is coming to the market, you know, it will be very comfortable for the poor people, because they have to now pay 3,000 to 4,000 rupees to buy the manual. Sphygmomanometer is not easy. An expert doctor is required to read it. But the digital meter, even an ordinary person who can read numbers can read it. So that is the advantage. Earlier, that was not there. For example, till some 5-6 years back, we used to have only the manual sphygmomanometer. But now digital one is available, but very costly. So substitute it with mobile is such a device, it can be integrated with any device. So any mechanical device can be integrated with it. Similarly, you can even think of using the mobile for reading the blood sugar directly by attaching a device. Now there is a technique, there is an app. You can read the blood sugar by the light. Optical reading can be done by mobile. But optical reading is always not correct, because error is more. But if you can just have a needle which can be just inserted to the body, a small needle without much pain you can insert. Like the blood testing done by the other blood testing meters are there. They are also very costly, around 2,000 rupees. So if you can have a small device by which a small needle can be inserted to your finger and the other end can be inserted to the mobile, it can read exactly the blood sugar count. So think of devising such a thing. We can patent it. I'm telling you to start some innovation. These are your area. It is electronics and computer area, these things. If you want, you can take the help of mechanical or how many of you will try this? Let me see. How many of you will try such small, small instruments which can make the life? And in this COVID period, this is all. Similarly, there is what is called an oximeter. That oximeter, you know, nowadays so many fraud cases are coming. That oximeter will be having a price of 500 to around 2,000 rupees based on quality. And it has got an optical reader. And now that oximeter is, people are being cheated. So if an engineering college can make a reliable oximeter and sell it, that will be a good idea. I want some of you to take up such ideas, innovation ideas. Who are interested in taking up these ideas? You contact either HOD CSE or HOD EC or HOD Triple. Even expenses we can bear from the college if you are interested in developing this. Try it. Okay. So I told that hypoxia. Hypoxia is the deficiency of oxygen in water, or either water or blood or wherever it is. And I was asking you what was the systolic and diastolic pressure that is required. Somebody please chat it. I think by this time you would have Googled. What is the systolic and diastolic pressure required in a human body? Anybody? Just put it. How much is the blood pressure?
80 and 120
are standard. Yes, 80 and 120 are the standard required. 80 for systolic, sorry, 80 for diastolic and 120 for systolic. That is the exact required, ideal case. But even if it is from 70 to 130, you can say it is okay. 70 to 130 is a bit aberrant, but 10 units only aberrant. But if it is less than 70, we can say that it is hypotension. Hypotension means less blood pressure. If it is above 130, we can say it is hypertension. It is hypertension. Okay. So some of you can check with a digital meter what is your blood pressure, and you can say whether some people do have hypotension, some people do have hypertension. Normally, aged people will have hypertension and the young people may have hypotension. That is what is said, like the long sight and short sight. Normally, young people will have short sight and aged people will have long sight. That's the natural makeup of the eye. Similarly, blood pressure, this is possible. But remember, many of the people are having the normal blood pressure only. And those people who are not having normal blood pressure, they will always have anxiety. Those who are having hypotension and hypertension will always have anxiety. So if you are having a lot of anxiety, you just check whether you have hypotension or hypertension, and even control of the food can control this hypertension or hypotension. So many food items are supposed to influence the blood pressure. Okay, that you can have some other medical reading on these matters. So I was just saying that hypoxia may also occur. Now, decreasing pH causes more metals to leach from soil and enter the stream because the pH is less. pH is nothing but negative logarithm of the hydrogen ion concentration. That is pH. Say for example, the hydrogen ion concentration is 1 in a million. Say you take a cup of water. The hydrogen ion concentration is 1 in a million. That means if you take 1 million molecules, one molecule is a hydrogen plus ion atom. Hydrogen plus ion. Okay, 1 in a million. 1 in a million means 10 raised to 6. So 1 in a million means 1 by 10 raised to 6. That is a hydrogen ion concentration. Or 1 by 10 raised to 6 is 10 raised to minus 6. And pH is the negative logarithm of that concentration. Negative logarithm means log to the base 10 of 10 raised to minus 6. That is plus 6. Are you following the logic? So pH is the negative logarithm of the hydrogen ion concentration. So if the hydrogen ion concentration is 1 in a million, I can say the pH is 6. Now let me ask a question for your common sense. I am saying that the hydrogen ion concentration, hydrogen ion is a positive ion. Actually, H plus and OH minus forms what is called water. H plus is hydrogen ion, OH minus is hydroxyl ion. So they combine to form water and energy. So let me ask a very simple question. I am saying that the hydrogen ion concentration in a small acid, in a cup of acid, is 1 by 1000. I'm just saying the hydrogen ion concentration in the acid in this cup is 1 by 1000. What is its pH? Can anybody tell? What is the pH? You have studied in your school days these things, but the correct concept may not be there. That is why I have told this. What is the pH of an acid? My question is this. What is the pH of an acid which is having hydrogen ion concentration 1 in 1000 or 1 by 1000? All other molecules will be H2O. Only 1 in 1000 molecules, it is a hydrogen ion, H plus ion. Then what is the pH? Somebody please put in the... This will not be available by Googling. You can apply common sense. Nobody is posting. Kirtana, can you tell me? Somebody has put in the chat box, what is that? Samina has already posted. Okay, then no need to ask. Samina, you are perfectly right. If it is 1 in 1000 means 1 by 10 raised to 3. 1000 is 10 raised to 3. So 10 raised to minus 3 is the hydrogen ion concentration. So pH is plus 3. Negative logarithm of the hydrogen ion concentration in the common logarithm scale. Common logarithm means to the base 10. And now I am saying that in clear water, pure water, the pH is 7. Pure water has got a pH of 7. So Akshaya says it is neutral. That means it is the ideal case. pH is 7. Yes, below 7 acidic and above 7 basic. That is shown in that slide I have shown. You can see on the right side what is a pH scale. 0 to 7 is acidic and 7 to 14 is basic, alkaline. Acidic and alkaline. Acid is having more hydrogen ion. Base is having less hydrogen ion. So neutral water means pH is 7. That is the best to drink. The best water to drink is neutral. pH 7. Okay. So it will be having 1 by 10 raised to 7 parts of hydrogen ion. So if you take a cup of water, 1 in 10 million will be 1 hydrogen ion. Only that much. If you take pure water, perfectly pure neutral water, in 10 million molecules, you will find 1 hydrogen ion free anion it is. It's called free ion. That is the presence. Okay? So don't confuse. Why I am telling this explained is, this pH is very important for electronics and computer science people also. Because, you know, many of the instruments are calibrated with respect to a particular pH. So when you get to instrument industry, this pH value, actually, I have asked some electronics people also, the concept of pH, they were not knowing. They just by-hearted pH is the negative logarithm of the hydrogen ion concentration. They couldn't explain what it is. So I have explained in a very simple term. You should never forget it. Try to recollect it. This is the meaning of it. Okay. So that pH scale is given on the right side picture. And you see that many of the metals do cause oxides. And most of these metal oxides combine with the acidity. That is why if the water is acidic, you know, if it is very concentrated acid, it will dissolve immediately. Except gold. Every metal will be dissolved by acid. That is why gold is so precious. Acids cannot mix or dissolve gold. Acid cannot dissolve gold. That is why the gold price is very high. All other metals can be dissolved by acids. But there is another solution which can dissolve gold also. But that is not a single acid. Have you heard its name? What is the solution? If you dip gold into it, it will become a white metal. Don't dip gold into it. That is the solution which is not commonly available, but some laboratories do have it for some experiments. Anybody knows the name of that solution which can dissolve gold? It makes gold a white powder. Anybody? Nobody. Heard of such a thing? That gold can be dissolved only by a certain solution? Yes. Acids cannot. Yes. Yes?
Mercury.
Samina has written mercury. Sina has written mercury. Sonia has written mercury. No, mercury cannot dissolve gold. Actually, mercury is a heavier metal than gold. So a metal can never dissolve another metal. A metal cannot dissolve another metal. Mercury can discolor gold, only surface. It cannot enter inside. Mercury can discolor the gold surface, but mercury cannot dissolve gold. No one knows that.
Sir, ஒரு ஆசிட்
Mercury is a
ஆனது
hyperactive metal. If it is not a single acid. I told you, no acid can dissolve gold. It's a
ആ സർ
mixture of acids.
പ്രൊപ്പോഷൻ ആയിട്ടുള്ള
That
എന്തോ
is
സർ
called, അതിന്റെ പേര് അക്വ റീജിയ എന്നാണ്. ഇറ്റ്സ് കോൾഡ് അക്വ റീജിയ. ഇറ്റ്സ് എ മിക്സ്ചർ ഓഫ് നൈട്രിക് ആൻഡ് സൾഫ്യൂരിക് ആസിഡ് ഇൻ എ പ്രൊപ്പോർഷൻ. ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് കോൾഡ് ദാറ്റ് പ്രൊപ്പോർഷൻ ഐ ഡോണ്ട് എക്സാക്ട്ലി റിമെമ്പർ. അത് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് നോട്ട് എ സ്റ്റാൻഡേർഡ് ഫ്രാക്ഷൻ. ഒരു ഒരു ഡെസിമൽ റേഷ്യോ ആണ്. ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് കോൾഡ് അക്വ റീജിയ. അക്വ റീജിയ എ യു ക്യു യു എ ക്യു യു എ ആർ ഇ ജി ഐ എ അക്വ റീജിയ. സോ ഇറ്റ് ഡിസോൾവ്സ് ഗോൾഡ്. So that is a method of cheating people, because earlier days the chemists who used to have this solution with them used to show the people that they can change the color of the gold, took from the people the gold and just immersed in it. So just immerse, sufficient gold will be dissolved into that. Then they give it out, wash it and give back. But the poor man will not know that a part of his gold has been dissolved in it. That used to be a black magic in the earlier days, used by some people. But nowadays, aqua regia is not very commonly available. Moreover, people won't give their gold to be immersed in a solution. That is also there. But I heard in the newspaper, I read in the newspaper that some places this has happened some years ago, that people were coming to their houses, they were asking the gold for cleaning purpose. They took the gold, dipped in a solution and gave back, cleansing with a sponge or something. So definitely the weight would have gone down, and these poor people will not know that their gold has been dissolved in that solution. Those people, they can the gold which is dissolved in aqua regia can be reclaimed. There's a technology for that. The gold which is in solution form in aqua regia can be taken back as gold. So it used to be a cheating technique earlier. It can happen even now. So don't give your gold to anybody to dip into any solution. Many of the jewelries will be having aqua regia for some specific purpose. Okay. Anyway, they may not dissolve, because while giving the gold and while taking back the gold, you can take the weight. And that is nowadays very easy, because now, earlier a balance was very costly. Now with 200 rupees, you can buy a very good electronic balance. And up to 10 kilogram, you can, recently I purchased an electronic balance which has got capacity up to 10 kilogram, 350 rupees only. So cheap it is. Once in a year, you'll have to change the battery. So have a balance at your home. Even that 10 kilo balance can measure up to 10 grams weight. But 10 grams is not enough for gold and all. Gold and all, you can buy a 100 grams balance, which can measure up to maybe milligrams capacity, up to 1 milligram. 1 milligram is enough to weigh gold. In laboratories and all, we keep a balance up to 1 milligram precision. Okay. So what I'm saying is, in this acidic solution, every metal other than gold will dissolve. So in the runoff water, you will have so many metals, iron, cadmium, nickel, etc., which will dissolve in the acidic water. And remember, rainwater will be mostly acidic. What is the reason why rainwater is mostly acidic? Rainwater is mostly acidic, not alkaline. Whereas the groundwater may be sometimes neutral. May not be alkaline, but neutral. Why the rainwater is always acidic? Let somebody tell that reason. Why is rainwater always acidic? Most of the cases. Anybody? Yes, anybody tell why is rainwater always acidic? Nobody has put in the chat box. It is not heavily acidic. Only the first rain will be highly acidic. Second rain onwards, it will be slightly acidic. I told in the last class, first rain you should not be exposed to. Then I told the reason also. I was just checking your memory capacity. I told that the first rain, first one or two rains, you should not stand and get it, because it is highly acidic. Whereas the third rain onwards, there is no risk. You can stand in the rain. Because it is not that much acidic. So what is the reason for acidity of rainwater? Now you can see. Very easy, yes. Revati has, Samina has written, acid contents from industries. Revati has written, sulfur dioxide contents, pollutants from atmosphere. Chelsea says, because of pollutant. Yes. But Samina is more correct. Acid content, because not only from industries, all other areas it can come. Why acid comes? Carbon monoxide in the atmosphere, in the presence of water, becomes carbonic acid. Sulfur dioxide and sulfur monoxide in the presence of water becomes sulfurous and sulfuric acid. Nitrogen dioxide and nitrogen oxide becomes nitrous acid and nitric acid. These are all very strong acid. In the first rain, in some areas of Los Angeles, the pH is as low as 2 to 3. In Kerala, it's not that much. I told Kerala is more humid. The atmospheric water content is so high, so the acid content may not be that much. But in many industrialized areas like Manchester and Los Angeles, Manchester is in England and Los Angeles is in the US, in these areas, the first rain may have an acid content as much as 3 pH. But after 2 or 3 rains are over, the pH may be very close to 7, 6.8 or 6.9, because all this acid have been washed away by the rainwater. But when you add, say, lemon juice, lemon is slightly acidic. Lemon is acidic slightly, but lemon juice is not acidic. Similarly, most of the fruit juices are like that, because when an acidic fruit is mixed with the water and you just mix it, and sugar also you add to it, and even if sugar is not added, that see, for example, there is citric acid in lemon, there is ferric acid in grapes. Similarly, different acids are there in different fruits. Most of the fruits do have acids, even some living organisms. For example, an ant is biting you. Why you get an itching sensation? ഒരു ഉറുമ്പ് കടിക്കുമ്പോൾ എന്തുകൊണ്ടെന്നാണ് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചൊറിയുന്നത്? വാട്ട് ഇസ് റീസൺ എനിബഡി നോസ്? ദി ആൻഡ് ബൈറ്റ് ഈസ് ഹാവിങ് എ വെരി ബിറ്റ് ഓഫ് ഫോർമിക് ആസിഡ് ആൻഡ് ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വാട്ട് വിച്ച് കോസസ് ദി ഇച്ചിങ് സെൻസേഷൻ ആൻഡ് നോട്ട് ഓൺലി ദ ആൻസ് അവർ ബോഡി ഓൾസോ എസ്ക്രീറ്റ് സോ മെനി അസിഡിക് തിങ്സ് ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ യു നോ ദി മോസ്കിറ്റോ വിൽ സെൻസ് യു വെറവർ യു ആർ Similarly, the leech. Leech means atta. Leech ennu paranjal ee raktham kudikkunna atta. The leech can sense you even at a distance of 15 meters. Why? Because our body releases a slightly acidic enzyme which is called pheromone. Pheromone is an acidic enzyme in our body. And everybody has got a different smell for their body. All of you have got smell for your body. And that smell will depend on your pheromone. And the smell of the pheromone may also depend on the food you have taken. And you would have heard some people say, I don't like his smell or I don't like her smell. Because the pheromone in your body may have a typical smell, which that person may not be liking. Similarly, the vice versa also. Some people like the smell of some people, saying that I like his smell very much or like her smells very much. Because that pheromone will be having a smell which is attractive to the other person. And that also will depend on what is the blood content of the other person. Okay, so it's all, you know, biological complications, all these things. So what I was saying is, most of the fruits, the juices may be, the juice by alone are highly acidic, but when mixed with water, it becomes, you know, highly, it becomes slightly alkaline. So every juice, it is better to add some water and drink instead of taking, you know, pure juice. But if when you are eating the fruit, say mango or orange is also having high level of citric content. When you are eating that fruit, it mixes up with your saliva and gets neutralized. So either you eat pure fruit, your body saliva mixes up and it neutralizes it. Or if you are drinking like juice, better add some good water, filtered and purified water. And instead of taking pure juice. Okay. But nowadays, you know, you get a lot of fruits in Tetra Pak packets. It is ultra heat treated. It can remain for months, around 6 months in the Tetra Pak. They are having slight water content also. They are not pure juice actually. It may be written on the outside it is pure juice. No, they have slight purified water content also. Okay, but comparatively they are better than any other bottled drink. Suppose you want to drink some juice, don't take chemical drinks like a fruity or something like Coca-Cola or Fanta or something. You can take UHT treated, you know, so many Realme juices there. Then, which are the other Tropicana is there? These are all comparatively better because they are heat treated, ultra heat treated, and Tetra Pak. So they will not be infectious. Okay. But carbonic drinks like Coca-Cola, Fanta, etc., will not be infectious for another reason. They are carbonated. They are having a lot of carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide in it, which makes carbonic acid. Carbonic acid kills all the organisms in it, and because of that, they will be highly acidic. You know, all the soft drinks will be acidic, and even Coca-Cola and Pepsi, the acidity is almost 3 pH. So if you drink them, you will have a lot of gas produced inside your body. Okay. So fruit drinks will not do that. Suppose you drink a Tropicana orange juice, it will not cause that much of gas inside. This is a common knowledge which you can have. Anyway, coming to the next one, which are the other pollutants which cause difficulty? Mostly lead and mercury are very, you know, poisoning elements. Lead is very common in the human life because till some 20 years back, all the plumbing in our household used to be with lead pipe. Lead pipe was used for instead of plastic pipe. Nowadays, it is plastic. Plastic is harmless to body, but plastic powder, if it is inside the pipe, that may be a difficult thing. So, plastic is not that dangerous, but the plastic powder inside the pipe is dangerous. But lead is not like that. Lead will dissolve in water up to an extent, especially when the water is acidic. Say some rainwater has mixed up with our water supply system. So the water supply system, the water gets a bit acidic. So lead will dissolve in it. And lead comes into our human body. And lead is such a thing, it's a systemic tolerant material. It will remain in the body forever. It will not go out. It will remain in the body and it will exceed the limit prescribed or permitted by the body, which is called the tolerance limit. And that may cause to so many things like loss of memory, like Alzheimer's disease. All this may be caused by lead poisoning. Then another thing is, you know, the memory, loss of memory. So by naturally, memory will deteriorate when you cross 50 years naturally. Because, you know, brain cells will be reoriented. What is the best technique to keep your memory active? I have never felt so far that my memory is fading. Because if you read continuously, if you listen continuously, your memory will never fade. But to those people who are not learning on a daily basis or reading on a daily basis, their memory will vanish. Especially if you say some, you know, farm workers, they don't read anything. They don't study anything. If you ask them after a 50 plus year old farm worker, you ask him about something which he has studied in the school days, he may not be able to reproduce because the reason is he has not been using his brain. So our brain is like, you know, a knife. If you throw it away somewhere, it will get rusted and, you know, its sharpness will be lost. Whereas if you use it daily, it will remain sharp. So lead is such a thing. Lead levels can be lowered using bacterial remediation also, because there are certain bacteria which eat lead. Some bacteria are there. So these bacteria have been used in water pollution removal, water treatment. We will come to those things in one of the slides. I'll be mentioning there the bacterial phenomenon or the bacterial process for cleaning the water. Then another thing which causes pollution is what is called the pesticide pollution. You know that pesticides, there are different sides. CIDES sides stand for those which are used for killing something. CIDES sides. I think the origin of that word is Greek or Latin. I don't exactly remember. Insecticide is for killing insect. Herbicide for killing herbs. Herb means ഹെർബ് മീൻസ് യുനോ സ്മോൾ പ്ലാന്റ്സ് അതിനാണ് ഹെർബ്സ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. ചെറിയ ചെറിയ ചെടികൾ, പായലുകൾ, അതിനൊക്കെ ഹെർബ്സ് എന്ന് പറയും. കുറ്റിച്ചെടികൾക്ക് ഒക്കെ ഹെർബ്സ് എന്ന് പറയാം. മലയാളത്തിൽ ഹെർബ്സിന് എന്താ പറയുക, കുറ്റിച്ചെടി എന്ന് പറയുന്നതാണ് ഉചിതം, ഹെർബ്സ്. ആൻഡ് ദെൻ ഫംഗിസീഡ്സ്, ഫംഗിസീഡ്സ് ഫോർ കില്ലിംഗ് ദ ഫംഗസ്. ഫംഗസ് യുനോ ഈസ് എ വെരി ദ ബെസ്റ്റ് എക്സാമ്പിൾ ഓഫ് എ ഫംഗസ് ഐ ക്യാൻ ടെൽ യു. സപ്പോസ് യു കീപ് യുവർ ബ്രെഡ് ഓപ്പൺ, ഒരു പാക്കറ്റിലെ ബ്രെഡ് ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഒരു മൂന്നാല് ദിവസം പുറത്ത് വെച്ചേക്കും. യു വിൽ സി ഇഫ് യു കീപ് ദി ബ്രെഡ് ഓപ്പൺ ഇൻ ദി എയർ ഫോർ സം 3-4 days, യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് യുനോ എ ബ്ലാക്ക് കളർ ഓൺ, an ash color, not black, ash color material you can see on the bread loaves. കണ്ടിട്ടുണ്ടോ നിങ്ങൾ ആരെങ്കിലും വീട്ടിൽ ബ്രെഡ് പൊട്ടിച്ച് പുറത്ത് വെച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടോ? യെസ് ഓർ നോ? എനിബഡി? എനിബഡി ഹാസ് കെപ്റ്റ് ബ്രെഡ് ഔട്ട്സൈഡ്? ഇല്ല. If you keep the bread outside for some 3-4 days, you will have a white form, an ash colored formation over it, and that is called the bread mold, 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 and that is a fungus. പൂപ്പ് എന്നാണ് അതിന് നമ്മൾ മലയാളത്തിൽ പറയാം, പൂപ്പ്, ബ്രെഡിൽ പിടിക്കുന്ന പൂപ്പ്, ദാറ്റ്സ് എ ഫംഗസ്. സിമിലർലി ഓൺ യുവർ ബോഡി സംസ് വെയർ ദ ബോഡി മേ ബി നോർമലി വെരി വെറ്റ് ഫ്രീക്വൻലി എസ്പെഷ്യലി അറ്റ് ദ ജോയിൻസ് യു മേ ഹാവ് എ ഡാർക്ക് പാച്ച്, ദാറ്റ്സ് എ ഫംഗസ്. സോ ഫംഗസ് ക്യാൻ ബി മോൾഡ് ഓർ ഈവൻ സ്പോർട്സ്, എ ബിഗർ സൈസ് ഫംഗസ് ഇസ് സ്പോർട്സ്. അതിങ്ങനെ പറന്ന് നടക്കുന്ന സൈസിലുള്ളതിനാണ് സ്പോർട്സ് എന്ന് പറയുക. And then rodenticide, rodent means what? Rodent nu parney kanyal eli annan idinekka namak rodent nu parayam, adayathu kadichu pottikuna natural jeevigalana, adine kollan vendi elivasham okku upayogikkille. So elivasham is what is called rodenticide. Fungus ne kollan vendi upayogikkuna fungicide, it's available in market. Fungicide, herbicide, insecticides, even elivasham, rodenticide, all these are available in market. They get into water after use. Say you are spraying insecticide for killing bugs or ants or anything, ultimately that insecticide will get into the atmosphere, its fumes will get into atmosphere, and the atmosphere it will mix up with water vapor, and ultimately it will go into the runoff water. Okay, and it was a study conducted. You see that last sentence, 1/4 of all the pesticides in the use in the US is for use in homes, gardens, lawns, parks, സ്വിമ്മിംഗ് പൂൾസ് ആൻഡ് ഗോൾഫ് കോഴ്സസ്, മീൻസ് ഡയറക്ട്ലി ഇൻ ടച്ച് വിത്ത് ഹ്യൂമൻ ബീങ്സ്. മൊത്തം ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്ന ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള വിഷങ്ങളുടെ നാലിലൊന്നും നമ്മുടെ വീടുകളിലും ചുറ്റുവട്ടത്തുമാണ് ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നത്. നാലിൽ മൂന്ന് ഭാഗം മാത്രമേ പാഡി ഫീൽഡ്സിലേക്കും വീറ്റ് ഫീൽഡിലേക്കും ഒക്കെ പോകുന്നുള്ളൂ. സോ ഇറ്റ് ഹാസ് ബീൻ ഡയറക്ട്ലി ഇൻ ടച്ച് വിത്ത് ദ ഹ്യൂമൻ ബീങ്സ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദിസ് ക്യാൻ ഓൾ കോസ് പൊല്യൂഷൻ, പൊല്യൂഷൻ ഓഫ് വാട്ടർ, ഡ്രിങ്കിങ് വാട്ടർ അൾട്ടിമേറ്റ്ലി. ദെൻ പൊല്യൂട്ടൻസ് മേ ബി കോൾഡ് ആസ് point pollutant and non-point pollutant. Point pollutant means it comes out of a single point. For example, the drainage pipe. For a particular drainage pipe, the water is coming out. That can be called a point discharge. That point discharge, if it is having pollutants, it may be called as point pollutant. Then, if it is in a long area, say for example, an entire agriculture land, the pesticide is coming and joining the water bodies, then it may be called a non-point discharge, or it is also called a line discharge. Then many of the pesticides and herbicides can cause lesions in the aquatic life. For example, the fish skin may be spoiled, and fishes and such things, if the skin is spoiled, they will die soon, because they are water organisms. Water organisms cannot live properly without the skin, not like land organism. Land organism, even if our skin is a bit cut or so, we may easily make up. But in water, what happens is the blood will lose out, and they cannot survive. So these things, especially the pesticides, herbicides, etc., will cause the fish to die. One more thing is, even if they are not dying, they are alive. When we catch the fish and eat it, even if the fish is not dead due to the pesticide, these pesticides will get into our body. And the pesticides have got a peculiarity. If they get into the human body, they stay over there. That is called the systemic poison. I told that. They accumulate in the human body till it becomes a level where our body cannot withstand it. Then we will surrender to it, we will succumb to it, and that is called a poisoning level. That is also called bioaccumulation or biomagnification. Bioaccumulation or biomagnification is nothing but accumulation is the process and magnification is the increased effect. Say mercury is coming slightly into our body, very slightly. Mercury can come through fish. Every day you are taking a particular fish which is having mercury. Let us say, I told you once such a case which is called Minamata incident. Entire people in Minamata Island in Japan died. Later, so after so many years, they found out that it was due to the mercury content in the fish available there. Okay, mercury in the fish you are taking daily, and the mercury will accumulate in your body till it becomes a level where it becomes poisonous to your body. Then your body starts surrendering or succumbing to it. So this can happen. This happens in every insecticide and every pesticide, because all the pesticides and insecticides will be having some, whether it is endosulfan or whether it is DDT, this bioaccumulation and biomagnification. Accumulation means adding up in the body. Magnification means multiplying its impact on the body. So both this can happen. That is very dangerous. And one example which is given here, DDT. DDT, I think I told in the last class, dichloro, diphenyl, trichloroethane. These are all called DDT, all come under a classification called organochlorines. Organochlorines are many more. Even carbon tetrachloride, you know, is poisonous. Carbon tetrachloride is something which you use for giving amnesia or to make people faint. But even that is poisonous. If it is consumed, you know, it is poisonous. So all this come under what is called organochlorines. And in the environment, you see on the right side of it, as the PPM level increases, the effect also will be more. Say, for example, at a level of 25 PPM, it can affect even big birds. But at a level of, you know, 0.04 PPM, it can affect only small zooplanktons. At a level of 2 PPM, it can affect fish. And maybe in the human body, we may need more PPM. Each poison will need maybe 100 PPM or 200 PPM to affect the human body. But even at lower levels, it can affect the miniature creatures. That is why we say poisoning the nature is always dangerous. We have now come up with so many techniques for avoiding this poisoning. But one thing is, most of these things which we use for pesticide, insecticide, etc., they are hormonally active agents, HAAs. Or hormonally active agents are called endocrine disruptors, because many of the poisons will affect the endocrines, the hormones in the body. Take for example, yesterday I was reading an article about infertility in Kerala. It is a research work done by Manohar Mariyar Sundaranar University. They have done an extensive research and found that 53% of the men and 42% of the women in Thiruvananthapuram district are having, you know, hormonal problems and infertility. In the first 10 years, they are not getting children. Maybe after a treatment only, some of them. But after the treatment, almost 90% of them are recovering. That is true. What does it mean? 53% of men and 42% of women in Thiruvananthapuram districts are naturally not reproductive. So they are treated. This is a study. It's a medical study, not a guesswork. So 90% of them after treatment can conceive. That's another thing. So this is called endocrine disruptors. Endocrine, say for example, endocrines are the hormones inside the human body. You know that the female hormone is estrogen and the male hormone is testosterone. Both these are endocrines. They will be disrupted by this chemical. So excessive use of poisoned food is more in Kerala, and they have also studied some districts in Tamil Nadu also. Kanyakumari districts and Tirunelveli district, they studied. They found that compared to Kerala, it is less there. Why? Because Keralites are using more junk food. especially food having these things, food having fertilizers, chemicals, and even high acidity. These things are also one of the main reasons for the infertility in the males and females. I was of the belief that this is a problem with the females only, but yesterday it has been a very clear indication to me that it is not a problem. See, more with the males. So you are all in the young age. Please be careful about the food you are consuming, because many of the food you take are endocrine disruptors. So if you want to read more about which are the food which are having poisons which disrupt the endocrines, you can have some internet study, because so many articles are there. This particular article I found in the Facebook or WhatsApp. I got it and then I read it casually. It was a long article. So endocrine disruptors are many in these pollutants. That is one of because if it happens like this, that paper says by around 20-30 years, almost 75% plus of our population can become victims of this endocrine disruptors. You know, in the famous novel Inferno by Dan Brown, he is releasing a virus to the atmosphere, and he claims that, you know, 2/3 of the population will be affected by this virus, and because their endocrine will be disrupted and they will not have progeny, their next generation will not be there. So this pollution is also causing something which is very dangerous. That is why, compared to some 20 or 30 years back, now, you know, the infertility rate has gone very high because of the pollution aspect. So it is not an easy thing. It is affecting human beings like anything. And I suggest that endocrine disruptors, there's a huge list of these hormonal imbalances which are caused. So with this, we stop today. And our next class, of course, tomorrow and after tomorrow, I'm having an AICT meeting. I have posted to you whether I can have substitute hours in Saturday, but nobody has responded. Am I right? So without your response, I am going to have it. Saturday, you are having classwork only for first 2 hours. And second hour is already mine. So third and fourth hours also I'll take. So that 3 hours I'll get from 10 to 1. In between, you can have some 15 minutes break. That is what my suggestion is. If anybody has got any other problem, you have to message me. So right now I am informing. Tomorrow and day after tomorrow, tomorrow there is no class. Thursday and Wednesday and Thursday, I'm having AICT meeting. So Wednesday and Thursday, I will not be engaging class. Friday, I'll be engaging. Plus Saturday, 10 to 1, 10:10, I think. My class starts at 10:10. 10:10 to 1, I'll take with some 15 minutes break in between. So we'll have 3 hours continuous so that I'll be able to finish most of the portion. Because you know that by 24th of June, we are closing all the essay classes. Then 30th onwards, your examination will commence. I think Dr. Binoy would have put the timetable by now. You can go through it. So that only 6 days. Moreover, it's an internal examination. So being an internal examination, we very, very specific about things that have been taught in the class. Because internal examination means question is being said by your teachers only. So while preparing for the examinations, be careful that you are studying the things discussed in the class more. And those who attended the class in full will have that convenience. This I've been telling from the very beginning. Okay. So thank you very much. Anything else to be asked, you can ask now. I'm here. If 1 minute I'm here. If you want to ask something, you can ask now. Others can quit.
Thank you, sir.
Okay then. Okay.
Thank you, sir.